In part 8 of our lesson on graphs of sine and cosine, you'll be sketching a cosine function. In this example, we'll sketch one complete period of the graph of y equals 1/3 cosine of pi x. It's CYU time, so pause the video, work the example on your own, then restart the video to check your answer. Okay, let's see how you did. The domain for all sine and cosine functions is negative infinity to positive infinity, meaning we can plug in every x value going in the positive direction and every x value going in the negative direction. We find the period by doing 2 pi over b. And remember, b is the coefficient of the argument. So in this case, b is equal to pi. So we have to do 2 pi divided by pi. So we find out that the period is equal to 2. The amplitude is the absolute value of a. And in this example, a is equal to 1/3. And the absolute value of 1/3 is 1/3. Now the range of every cosine graph starts out negative 1 to 1, and then it is affected by the amplitude, which in this case is 1/3. So this will be a vertical compression, and our range will be negative 1/3 to positive 1/3. Next, we have to solve the inequality for the new cycle. We know we start out by saying 0 is less than or equal to the argument, which is bx, is less than or equal to 2 pi. So in our case, we're going to solve 0 is less than or equal to pi times x is less than or equal to 2 pi. Then we're going to divide every piece of the inequality by pi. And remember, pi is just a number, just like 7 is a number, or 3 is a number, or 1/2 is a number. So dividing 0 by pi, we get 0. The middle term becomes x, and the last term becomes 2. And this interval from 0 to 2, the length of that interval is 2, and that agrees with what we said the period was going to be. So we feel like we're off to a good start here. We know that our graph is going to start at x equals 0, and it will end at x equals 2. And of course, this is starting and ending for the one cycle that we're doing. We know that the cosine graph would go on forever and ever in both positive and negative directions. So when we refer to start and end, we're just talking about our one cycle that we're graphing. So now we're ready to find our five key points. We know that our graph starts at 0 and it ends at 2. Pretty easy to do these calculations. The midpoint from 0 to 2 is going to be 1. The midpoint from 0 to 1 is going to be 1/2. And the midpoint from 1 to 2 is going to be 1.5, which we can write as 3/2. Now we see we're going to want to write all of our x values with a denominator of 2, so 0 stays 0, 1/2 stays 1/2, 1 becomes 2/2, 3/2 stays the same, and 2 is 4/2. So we can see when we double check our x values that each one goes up by a half. So it starts at 0 and goes 1 half, 2 halves, 3 halves, 4 halves. And when you make your graph, you can either write them with the denominators of 2, or if you prefer to write them in the simplified form, that's fine as well. Now we're ready to look at our expected y values. We know that we're graphing y equals 1/3 cosine of pi x. So this is a cosine graph, so we expect our y values to go 1, 0, negative 1, 0, and 1. We know that a is equal to 1/3, and that will have to multiply all of our y values. So 1 times 1/3 is 1/3, 0 times 1/3 is 0, negative 1 times 1/3 is negative 1/3, 0, positive 1/3. We know that we're required to check at least one value that is not a root. So let's check this endpoint here. We're going to, we could use 4 halves, but why not make life easy? Plug in 2. So we can take the 2 and we're going to plug it in for x here. So we'll get 1/3 cosine of pi times 2. Now we know that the cosine of 2 pi is equal to 1. So this did work out to be 1/3. Now those of you that checked this value, I can show you how that would have worked. If we took the 1 and plugged it in here, we would get 1/3 cosine of pi times 1. And of course the cosine of pi is equal to negative 1, so we would get negative 1/3. So whichever value you checked, you just want to make sure that it's working out to be what you expected it to be. Now we're ready to plot these points. And again, you can write them with their common denominator, or you can write them in their simplified form. Either way is fine. So we can come over here to the graph. We know we have 1 half, 2 halves, 3 halves, and 4 halves. We know that our y values have to go from negative 1/3 to positive 1/3. I'm not going to want that to be tiny little y value, so I'll probably stretch that out. Maybe I'll put negative 1/3 here and positive 1/3 here, just so my graphing is a little bit easier to see. Now we're ready to plot those points. We have the point 0, 1/3, 1 half, 0, 2 halves, negative 1/3, 3 halves, 0, and 4 halves, 1. Connect our key values with smooth curves. And there's our graph of y equals 1/3 cosine of pi x. We're being asked to solve an equation to find all the x-intercepts and to use it to find 3 roots. Remember that x-intercepts and roots are 2 words for the same thing. We know that what we have to do is take the argument of the function and set it equal to the places where the x-intercepts normally occur. So the normal roots for cosine. Now, if we look at our summary chart for sine and cosine, we see that the normal roots for cosine are going to occur at pi over 2 plus n pi. On the left-hand side, we have the argument of our trig function, which is pi times x. My suggestion to you is to turn the right-hand side into a single rational expression, so let's get a common denominator. We know we would need to multiply this second term by 2 over 2, so this is going to become pi plus 2n pi over 2. The left-hand side is still pi x. Now we're ready to multiply both sides by 1 over pi, or divide by pi, however you want to think of it. If we take the left-hand side times 1 over pi, we have to take the right-hand side times 1 over pi. The left-hand side becomes x, and on the right-hand side, now this pi has to divide this pi, which would become a 1, plus, and it will have to divide this term, so it'll cancel that pi, and we get a 2n divided by 2, and this is the formula that we'll use to generate all the roots of the function. So now we're ready to plug in values for n, and we're being asked to find three roots. So again, I'll probably pick the easiest integers I can think of, negative 1, 0, positive 1. Now if we plug negative 1 in for n, then this becomes negative 2, so we're going to have 1 minus 2 and get negative 1 over 2. If we plug in 0 for n, it'll wipe this term out and we get 1 over 2. And if we plug a 1 in there for n, this becomes 2. 1 plus 2 is 3 over 2. And when we look at our graph that we just created, we see indeed we have roots at 1 half and 3 halves. And if the graph continued, if we had graphed more of it, more cycles of it, we would have found going in the negative direction that there would be a root at negative 1 half, because there are going to be infinitely many roots going in both directions.